pase. Pierna derecha, directo al arco. ¡Golazo! ¡Golazo! ¡Golazo!
The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Mullins and Kevin Larame, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night, and welcome to Soccer Today for Monday, February 21 or 21st, 2022. I'm Kev Larame, joined by Duane Rollins by video. Duane, how are you today?
I'm live, and I'm not wearing tux. Where'd the tux go? I lost the tux.
You lost the tux, and welcome to Soccer Today on this beautiful Monday. Yes, you can see us on video, and of course, we will be broadcasting on YouTube from now on. We have more, or I say better, video quality on YouTube, and we can control a lot more. And Duane and I will have a same as always, but now on YouTube for the video aspect of the show. Podcast hasn't changed, but Duane, how was your weekend?
Pretty good. You know, I mean, City lost. We'll talk about that tomorrow, because what are Tuesdays for?
Well, Tuesdays are for Europe, but today it's for CCL. CF Montreal plays tomorrow in the CCL. We'll talk about CF Montreal at the Big O, because Duane, the Big O is back in our lives tomorrow night. That'll be fun. Kei Kamara has signed with CF Montreal. We'll break down his career statistics, some surprising numbers I found earlier today. We'll look at the CCL the upcoming week too, because we have a very busy week in the CCL in the next few days. But Duane, let's go through your studio for a second. What can you tell us about the scarves you have behind you? It is the first time we have a video, so might as well talk about a little bit about Paris and Manchester City.
Yeah, I got this when I was in Paris. That's why I have a Neymar scarf on this, and it was the only thing I could get. It. I needed something. I also have a French jersey, which maybe I'll wear on air one day. This is the Diro testimonial scarf, which is hilarious. I paid way too much money for that. It's not very good either. This one, of course, is my favorite one. I think it is the 2020 Voyageurs Cup final scarf, half and half.
That never happened yet. That's hilarious. It's the final that hasn't happened, that maybe will one day happen. Who knows? But, you know, let's talk about our bread and butter. We're excited. It's the first time we both are on video, so we're excited. And thank you for subscribing to our YouTube channel, if you haven't, which you can just easily hit the button below the bottom of your screen now and hit that notification bell so you know when we have a new video uploaded. Also subscribe on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. Let's dive into it, Duane. This week, it's CCL week. Yes, Major League Soccer will be back also Saturday on the 26th and the 27th. Montreal will play on Saturday, on Sunday, on the 27th in Orlando. But Duane, it's CCL week. Let's have a look at where things are right now in the CCL. Just quickly look at the schedule for this week. We have a busy schedule. No, New England's not playing tomorrow against AS Cavalier. It was postponed, canceled. AS Cavalier forfeited. CF Montreal will host Santos Laguna at the Big O at 8 p.m. Lyon versus the Avocados of Guastatoya at 10:15 tomorrow. Also, a busy week in the CCL. It's going to be fun.
Will be fun. Do you have the fever yet? The CCL fever? We always have to talk about that a little bit.
Well, it's kind of different now, because fever could be a lot of things during this COVID period. So I'm kind of always careful. I do not have the CCL fever, but I am getting excited for a big game tomorrow night.
Yeah. Montreal, it's always nice to get live soccer back. What is the capacity? Do you have full capacity in Montreal? Or
50%. And this is, of course, under reserve. I'm not 100% sure of the restrictions, but I believe it's 50%. Fans will be at the Big O. Tickets have been sold. And when we look at CF Montreal or the Montreal Impact since 2012 at the Big O, there's quite an advantage. And looking at the numbers, I thought, I'm actually surprised, because I remember a lot of the losses and a lot of the draws. I didn't remember, I guess, the 10 wins all that much. 21 games in all competition, Duane, at the Big O since 2012, since CF Montreal Impact joined MLS. 10 wins, 3 losses, 8 draws, 33 goals for, 22 goals against. And that is, of course, Major League Soccer's regular season, playoffs, and CCL, and also Canadian Championship, all mixed together. Quite an advantage for Montreal, and Montreal is down 1 goal after the first leg.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's a lot to say about the Big O, which is a place that's actually near and dear to my heart, although it is, I think we can both agree, you know, it's seen better days, we'll say. you know, if you go to the top level, I love walking around the top wall. It's like you see like OV bottles from like the Olympics, literally still there, you know, like.
Well, we've talked about this, and I found a newspaper on a table that was 2 years old one day. So that was like in the CCL time in 2014, I believe. Anyways, we saw old cigarette like butt that was like from brands that don't even exist anymore. Yeah. There's a few things like this that exist. It's always a little trip back in time at the Big O, and I'm excited to go later this week.
No, for sure. Like I said, I mean, it's got some charms. I watched Bruce Jenner. It was about him as Bruce, or her as Bruce. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, there was this documentary, and it was so weird to see that place new and fresh and clean. The archive image from 1970 is amazing. Anyway.
Finished, like also half built, but yes.
Yeah, no, that's hilarious. It still kind of isn't fully built, and it's, you know, when did you pay it off? Like 10 years or 5 years ago or something?
A few years ago, like it's still fresh in my memory. And of course, smokers in Montreal are the one who paid for that. Well, smokers in Canada, to be fair, are the ones who paid for that stadium.
Yeah. Look, in terms to get this back on topic of the game, what the big advantage, the biggest advantage, I guess, if you could call it that, would probably be getting used to that playing surface, because it's, how do you delicately put this? It is the worst turf you will ever see in your life. It is, like, if you've ever walked on it, it's like, well, it's concrete, basically. Like, it's old school AstroTurf is what it is. And it's, yeah.
It literally is. Let's have a look here. I had a funny video here, which is basically a zoom in to the turf. If you're watching us by video, thank you for subscribing to our YouTube page at youtube.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. This is during the setup, a picture that was taken a few years ago during the setup of the turf. That's the newest turf they've been using. And of course, it's not an ideal situation. It's far from it. It looks a whole lot like your friend's backyard turf, but a bit more budget. And of course, we're being dismissive here a little bit, but it is, of course, not an ideal situation for anyone.
No, I mean, look, people talk about it all the time in terms of what that place is. Now, the one question I do have is, did they hire better measurers of the lines? Like, are there better grounds?
I believe so. I think since that fiasco in 2016, I don't think we'll see that happen ever again. You know, the famous saying, measure twice, paint once, is going to be living up to the hype in Montreal.
Yeah, look, I'm not a conspiracy guy, and we got to be careful with conspiracies now, but I'm not entirely convinced, and never will be, that that wasn't done on purpose to sell more beer. just a theory, but anyway.
It might have worked, though. I
bought a lot of beer.
I remember being... As we have Duane's phone, who just decided to take a little tumble, I remember being part of the press box and having literally a lot of time to browse everything while we're looking at people painting on the grass. It was quite an impressive paint job, and quite an impressive paint job for the green paint. But we're digressing, and we'll be back to talk about, of course, the Big O and the painting. But Duane is back after a little tumble. And of course, thank you for following us. And those are the kind of things that we're working through doing videos, and it's kind of fun, you know. But that's why I also love to control video and the audio. Because this is not doing by StreamYard. This is not done by the ways you think this is doing. I basically have video feeds and I control. So, Duane, I was able to move you off screen when I was seeing the tumble. It's okay.
Yeah, it went under my stove. I had to go get a stick to pull it out. But anyway.
It was amazing. But as we have Duane back in his wonderful studio, by the way, I'm really happy about it. We've talked about the turf. We've talked about the Big O. A player that will not be there tomorrow night, Duane, because, of course, it's 23-man roster for the CCL that was announced and unveiled a few weeks ago, so we won't have Kei Kamara tomorrow for the CF Montreal. But CF Montreal have found a striker for the meantime to help with the depth at the striker position. It was a problem. It hasn't been addressed during the offseason. There was some injuries, of course, to Mason Toy once again into a young academy player. But now, Kei Kamara, maybe 6-7 years too late, but Kei Kamara has signed with CF Montreal. And you know, Duane, when we look at his statistics in his Major League Soccer career, both in regular season and the playoffs, I found some interesting aspect. 374 games played, 310 starts, 166 goals, 66 assists. We've talked about last year how corners were my favorite stats of the year. This year, it's goals and assists per 90. I love that stats. It gives you an influence of the player on the game, on the results, on a time period. And this one, the sample size is big. He's been playing in Major League Soccer for a decade now. And he has a goals plus assists per 90 of 0.62, which means on an average season, almost every game, he will have either a goal or an assist, or two games out of three, he will have a goals and an assist. And to me, for a player in Major League Soccer that might be up there in age now, if even Montreal gets half of that production, so a goal or an assist every four or five games, it would be better than what they had over the last few seasons by their strikers.
No, look, I mean, 100%. Kei Kamara is a great player, and by all accounts, a great human being. And I think that's important, too. I mean, look, he's had a... This is the second Canadian team he's played for. That puts him on a list of about 20 players that have played for two Canadian teams in MLS. And that's a pretty interesting sort of statistic to look at as well, just from a trivial perspective. But, yeah, no, let's get your bingo cards out. One day we're going to make a bingo card. We're going to actually make a bingo card, and we'll hold it off here. But
we'll make T-shirts, like a T-shirt that has the bingo card on it, and you can stamp it or something.
One of the terms that we use all the time is MLS lifers, right? Like an MLS lifer and how important they are to a successful team. Like, you know, your superstars are great. You can bring in these great DPs and that, but if you don't have a core of guys that you can rely on and know this league and understand the quirks of it and understand the travel and have gone through it, then you're not going to be successful. And he is, you know, if you're going to make a T-shirt, speaking of T-shirts, it said MLS lifer, you'd put Kei Kamara's face on it. Like, he is the epitome of an MLS lifer.
You would do two things, that and the heart-shaped hands, which I can't really do justice on TV here. I'm not really good at it. But yeah, you're better than I am in doing that thing. But it's true. And I think that is a good aspect, because even though he might not be the savior and score 20 goals for Montreal this year, it hasn't been easy the last year in CF Montreal fandom. The relationship with the fans has not been easy. And right away, after the announcement of signing Kei Kamara and seeing the reaction on social media, we saw fans being happy. Fans saying, I love this guy. Fans reacting already of him sliding with his kids, like sledding on snow, doing Montreal things. People were already happy and already in love with him. So that's going to be a great narrative this season. The contribution of Kei Kamara to CF Montreal. And to me, that contribution might not be just on the pitch. It might be a relationship with the fans. It might be also bringing some joy, some life in the locker room. And who knows? There's a good way to bring that mental... He's always been in shape, right? Kei Kamara's never been a player who's been talked about and not being in shape, or there's other things that were talked about and not necessarily for all good reasons. According to him, it was not necessarily his fault too. There were some people talking about toxicity in locker room, but I think it was more conflict of personalities over the last decade. Sometimes it happens with some players in the different teams you play with. I don't think that was the question here. Kei Kamara joining CF Montreal for the depth, and maybe late in game he brings a couple goals this season, and maybe that brings you a couple points. And if CF Montreal had a couple more points last year, well, they would have made the playoffs.
Right. There's another, I guess, bingo card there. Funny, you were talking about the locker room and, like, kind of the personality. And I think that's really important. I mean, there's the player that left Toronto recently that basically made the locker room toxic last year. And I'm not even going to say his name. You know who I'm talking about, folks. But at any rate, my story that I've... There's a good tie-in with this scarf here, this D-Row scarf. Kei Kamara actually was in that game, and we'll never forget his interactions with the crowd. And he had played the day before, flew up to go to D-Row's testimonial, which was for charity and all the good things. And he's standing in the corner by the south end, and we're all, you know, giving him a little bit of a hard time. Who are you? Who are you? And he turned around, and he looks at us and gives us a big shrug, and his smile lit up the room, and we all just sort of applauded him off. He's clearly... You know, he's got personality, and he's a big guy, and he's a guy that, you know, played the night before, flew to Toronto, and then flew back.
Very charismatic. Charismatic. It reminds me of a professional wrestler in a way, where he's going to find a way to engage with the crowd, and if the crowd treats him as the villain, as the heel, he'll embrace it. He'll come and look at the crowd and be like, yeah, give it to me. It's fine. I can take it. And then the other way around, if he's the hero, he's going to bring you that moment, that wholesome moment of the heart-shaped hands and the hug and taking pictures with your children. That's kind of like what we want to see here.
Yeah, and look, the MLS lifer, it doesn't do it justice, as I said, because, look, this guy came into the league, I believe, the year before the Chivas and RSL expansion, which means that when he came into the league, there was only 10 teams in it. He's now played for 9 teams, which is kind of an impressive situation. He has seen this league go from MLS 1.0 all the way to whatever point all we're in now. And that's an invaluable sort of experience. And anyone who talks to him, his time in Vancouver, said that he was such a mentor to Alfonso Davies. And Alfonso Davies, I think, has mentioned this directly as well, how important he was. So, like, mm-hmm. you can't measure that stuff. Like, we can pull a stat board up, but you can't put that. There's no stat there, right? Like,
no.
he's a good influence.
And here's another example, and this is taken from Patrice Bernier in social media. It was Frédéric Laure and Patrice Bernier who were talking about. I think it was Patrick Marcellet, actually, who's a celebrity in TV here in Quebec, who was talking about Patrice Bernier on his social media. And remembering in 2018 when Patrice Bernier played his last game in the Montreal Impact uniform, last game in Major League Soccer, last game of his career too, the first person to come over and hug Patrice Bernier on that game was Kei Kamara. It was against New England Revolution, and it was Kei Kamara on one of his last game with that team, and he came and hugged Patrice Bernier. So it's another example of Kei Kamara showing that charisma and that attitude and that likeness, I guess you...
Likeability.
Yeah, likeability is better. Yeah, likeability is great. And I think we're going to see that unfold in a good way here for Montreal. And maybe that's the one aspect Montreal didn't have last year. The one veteran MLS player that can bring some wisdom. You had great players, like you still have Victor Wanyama, who's not as old as we think he is, but a bit youth, yes, but of mileage-wise, right? But when we look at him and his experience, it's not the same in MLS as a Kei Kamara. So I think the dichotomy there of the old veteran from the league with veteran from outside the league and the young players from the system of Montreal, from other system in this MLS, I think will show great things. But yeah, this is a good thing for Montreal, Kei Kamara.
No, for sure. I mean, there's, you know, I don't know what the number is, and we'd have to see the number to fully evaluate it, but I doubt it's much because Kei Kamara's played a long career and he probably isn't longing for money. So he's probably on a very reasonable salary, like decent, but reasonable.
Yeah. And it's by the way, 1 year contract for this year with an option for next year. So there's also a possibility, if results are great, that we see him next year.
Yeah, he's in shape. I mean, he just played the African Cup of Nations. So, you know, this is a guy that just played an international tournament and had played briefly in Finland, I believe, which he was out of the league for a little bit. But he knows his way around a locker room. He knows his way around this league, and it's, you can't say much more. Now, in terms of what he'll do on the pitch, I think having that late game, that 20 minutes, that's what his role will be. I can't see him as a regular starter. If he's a regular starter, there's probably been a problem, honestly. But if you can have a guy score 5 to 10 goals off the bench, then that's the difference between playoffs and not, basically.
Exactly. And we'll see if he brings that contribution with Montreal. We won't see him play tomorrow night in the CCL, but we for sure will see him maybe feature Sunday in Montreal's first game of Major League Soccer's regular season, because MLS is back this weekend. But before that, we have the CCL. Tomorrow, the CONCACAF Champions League resumes, and we'll break down the matchup all across the board, from Montreal to even Seattle. And we'll start after this short break right here on Soccer Today.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sports podcasting network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kev Larame with Duane Rollins in video again. Thank you for joining us and thank you for your patience as we work through some of the kinks. I know the audio is not what you used to be, and we're going to bring it back to the level we want, but we wanted to do this video thing and to bring Duane's glorious image on your television screen everywhere, as he is happy to be here also with you all. Duane, let's talk about the CCL. CF Montreal will face Santos Laguna in their second leg of the CONCACAF Champions League round of 16. And that will start tomorrow at the Big O, the old Olympic Stadium, at 8 p.m. tomorrow. New England Cavaliers, that's canceled, of course, because Cavaliers couldn't get their act together and get the visas in time. Lyon Guasatoya, that is taking place tomorrow night, so a busy evening. New York City FC Santos Equapiles, 6 p.m. on Wednesday. and we see all the scores and the aggregates here. I guess most of the matchups in this week's CCL, Duane, are pretty even still. Nothing really out of reach. Maybe outside of that Guastatoya game. Guastatoya is down 2 goals heading into Mexico, and I don't think they'll bridge that gap. I think Lyon will make it all the way through the quarterfinals. But out of all the matchups that are going to take place this week, which one has you excited so far?
I kind of want to watch NYCFC because I'm really interested to see what that team is and whether they can continue the momentum. Obviously, I'm here in Canada, and the team that I talk about the second most is Montreal. So clearly that one's interesting to me as well. And we've talked a lot about them already today. But yeah, in terms of the MLS sides, you want to sort of gauge where they're at. The season's going to be interesting because it's starting so soon and it's more of a sprint this year. To me, I think, anyway, I'd have to do the math on that, but I do believe it's more condensed. So I think it might be pretty significant for those teams to have these couple extra games under their belt before they hit the ground running on the weekend. I would actually put it as quite a considerable advantage. And if you can take, even if you bow out, like, honestly, if I'm evaluating the Montreal game, I think probably Santos might win that game, to be honest with you, but I still think it's a beneficial situation for Montreal to have played in them because it's going to allow them to enter MLS running. And it's, you know, I will always maintain that as much as I enjoy the CCL, it's more important that you do well in the league. That's going to get your attention, right?
Of course. And Montreal had great moments in the CCL. You see some on your screen, of course, at the big go. And we were both there in 2015, and I think your ears are still broken from that.
Yeah.
From that goal against Club America you see on your screen, of course, now. And it was a great time over the years at the big O. We know Montreal's got an advantage there. We'll see if it's enough to overturn the one-goal deficit, because that's the problem right now for Montreal. They have one-goal deficit heading into the second leg. We can now look also at the other games that are taking place in the entire of this round. To me, Duane, Santos de Guapiles is two goals down. You mentioned New York City FC will probably do a good job there. I'm intrigued by Seattle Motaga. The last game in the round of 16, Seattle will face Motaga at the place used to be called the CenturyLink Field, but now it's called Lumen Field. Which, you know, I always go there and I'm like, I'm wondering if I need to bring my Lumen calculator, because that's Lumen just it's a unit of measure of light, okay? It's not a company name, anyways.
Yeah, I mean, I can't keep track of the corporate sponsors' names. It's you know, whatevs. I mean, I hate corporate sponsor, but at the same time, I will forever refer to, you know, BMO Field as BMO Field, and that is the Bank of Montreal. So there you go, which is hilarious.
Yes, and of course, the crew should have always kept their Barbasol sponsorship.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Barbasol. Who doesn't need shaving cream? Well, I don't use it a lot, as you can
obviously
see. So.
Yeah, exactly. And if you were to use it, maybe you use it more for your head than for your beard.
Yeah, once a month or so, I'll shave it down. I usually just use a clipper, but anyway.
Which is, by the way, we could talk about these things now because we have a video feed. So those are the things that are different. That
we see the clipper right there.
All right, let's have a look at the bracket too, because we've talked about how Montreal, if they beat Santos Laguna this week, they're going to face Cruz Azul or Forge in the quarterfinals. Then potentially Pumas Unam. So it could be three Mexican teams even before you reach the final. And then you could have Leon in the final. You could have four Mexican teams to win the CCL for Montreal. So how do you play this if you're CF Montreal? And we're going to be pragmatic here. The season starts really quickly on Sunday. You have one more day than other teams that are playing in the CCL. That's good. But should you prioritize the CCL? Like, is tomorrow's matchup really the priority for Wilfried Nancy? Should you just do your best, make sure you don't get maybe blown out, no embarrassment, but also you don't force it playing your 18, 90 minutes? Let's say the Kyotos of this world should not play 90 minutes tomorrow night. What do you think?
Yeah, it's a dilemma for sure, and different MLS teams have treated it differently. You know, for instance, I remember the Rapids. They drew Toronto in what was that 20? I think it was the 2018 run, the first round, and they outright said it that they were treating it as preseason games, like an opportunity for them to get through. They knew they weren't going to win it, so they weren't going to do anything more. It was just part of their preparation for the season. Whereas other clubs, of course, have gone in full blazing. If I'm Montreal into that game, you're in a difficult situation because you are playing at the Big O and you're playing in front of your fans. And as you say, there hasn't been, you know, perfect relations with some of them, particularly the One Ultras group, for a while, right? So you don't want to completely, you know, watch the bed. But at the same time, I think probably internally there's a, you know, there's an understanding that in this part of the revolution, what's more important for them is to continue to develop and move forward and make the playoffs this year and, you know, win the Voyagers Cup in the fall. You got to build to that so you can get into this. To win it, like, if you beat four Mexican teams in a row, you deserve it. But I saw it firsthand how much toll that takes on it, and you don't want to have your season do this, right, in the bowl.
So if we're quite honest, if you are a CF Montreal fan, you kind of hope for like a 2-1 loss tomorrow night or something like that, even like a 1-1 draw. Like, hey, we tried it. We almost got there. We even scored against them, but at the end of the day, we lost. And then you focus 100% on the league and eventually the Canadian Championship, which might be the best plan. And when we look at the progression of CF Montreal, de Olivier Renard and Wilfried Nancy, this is more where they are. They're not in a position where the CCL should be a target. The CCL is kind of like that cherry on top of the sundae after you already won the league, though.
Yeah, it's the CCL is a weird thing for the three Canadian teams because, I mean, realistically, it's one of them's getting in. And like last year, none of the three teams were particularly great. I mean, the Whitecaps made the playoffs, but you know my opinion on that. That's not much of an accomplishment when half the teams in the league make the playoffs.
And when you take out Brian Dwight's contribution and the fact that he played over his head for the last 7 weeks of the season, it's a totally different game.
Yeah, we'll talk about the Whitecaps in the preview down there. Spoiler, I don't think I'm going to place them that high because I don't think he's going to replicate that, but we'll see. And Whitecaps fans, at me. You can send me a scarf, too. I'll put a Whitecaps scarf on.
Sure. Yeah, you can send me one too. But you're right. And when I look at the Whitecaps too, and we'll break that down, it's a transition period from the goalies to other. It's a time where this year won't necessarily be the be on end all of the Whitecaps. But it's going to be a fun week of CCL. And of course, tomorrow on the show, we'll break down some of the matchup in Europe from last weekend. We'll look at the Premier League. We'll look at our other matchup. We'll also look at the CCL. And we'll set up the rest of the week because, Duane, before next Monday, the season will have started. So a literally 7 days from now, we'll be breaking down Major League Soccer regular season games.
That's crazy to me. But, you know, as I said, last year was the longest and shortest year in the history of the world simultaneously. So I guess we're ready to go. It's February. Like, it is freezing. I can't even comprehend the idea that there's going to be live soccer in this city in about 3 weeks. So like, anyway.
I know. And you're not the only one, but some people don't know what they're talking about because there's a big rumor, and right now we can finish the show on this. Big rumor that Neymar is gearing up to come to Major League Soccer very soon. And because you have your Neymar scarf, might as well talk about it. Neymar doesn't know how things are going. He's like, the off-season is like 3 months. I'll have a lot of time to have a lot of time off. Dude, if you think you're coming to MLS to have some time off first and 3 months time off, I got a little news for you. You won't. You won't have 3 months off. And it's going to be a lot more difficult than you think.
That's the thing about that Europeans don't necessarily, well, he's not European, I get that, but players from European leagues is what I meant, don't necessarily always understand. They think if they come over to MLS thinking it's a retirement league, they're going to be found out. Like Pirlo was found out. You know, I can still see him standing there on the back post, like just going, you really want me to mark this guy? Like,
and the ball just doing tuck, tuck, tuck in front of him. There's a goal. He hasn't moved. And he's like, I need to be on a beach somewhere.
Yeah, why am I here? I don't need the money. Why am I here?
Why am I playing at Yankee Stadium in a phone booth? I won the World Cup, goddammit.
Yeah, no, it's you have to come over with the right attitude. It's a very athletic league. If you do come over with the right attitude, you know, you can. I would never sign a guy like Neymar for an MLS contract. Ibra, okay, that's pump my brakes a little bit there. Neymar is highly talented. He'd do fine, but he wouldn't do as fine as he could because I think he'd be half-assing it most of the time. I think Ibra was half-assing it half the time, but he was just so much better.
And do you know why he actually gave a, you know what, and sometimes we're actually doing well? Because he has such an ego. Like, he could probably not bear destroying his legacy or going there and people think, he's shit, you know? He had to be like, you know what, I'm going to have to work hard a bit. I'm going to have to put a bit more work than I thought I was just because it's my name here. Same bit like Drogba. Like, Drogba didn't play this way when he went to Galatasaray or China for the very short time he was there. But in Montreal, like, well, I guess people see what I'm doing. people in Europe are talking about it. And if I don't do well, they will put the highlight on it in Europe. And I kind of have to make sure I don't destroy my reputation here.
No, 100%. I think, but if I'm going to sign a DP, to me, the perfect one to sign is ones that are have a bit of a chip on their shoulder. The reason I think Sebastian Giovinco did so well in the league was because of that. I mean, he's the chip on Sebastian's shoulder is bigger than Sebastian, who's not very big. But
the chip is the chip. Then there's like the shoulder, then the ant.
Yeah, exactly. and but he came over here with something to prove, and he, you know, for 5 years or whatever he did, and then he went to some place that was more invisible, and I think he started to lose it. And we'll see how he does in Italy. Of course, he's signed back over there now. But
By the way, we didn't talk about it. He signed for Sampdoria after a training stint of, 2 days with Toronto in Florida. And he went to Sampdoria, and now we'll be back in Serie A. Is it Serie A or Serie B? Are they in the second tier? No, they're the first tier, right?
Serie A. There's rumors. I don't know if it's wishful thinking or rumors in the city that they might, you know, budgetarily speaking, that they might bring Giovinco back for the second half of the season, because then you could only have half the cut hit on the salary cap, right? We'll see. But, I mean, it's a nostalgia signing for sure. I'm not sure he still has it. We'll see. If he can go over to Italy and light it up, then I'm sure he'll get interest over there. But his family still lives in the city, so that's why he wants to come back here. The training stint was look, there's a relationship there, and it was nice to sort of see them mend that a little bit, because he is an important player to the city and to that team, of course. And you know, I am, as a fan, I'll speak as a fan for a second, fan hat goes on, I would dearly love to be in the South End when he's lining up a free kick one more time and, you know, oh, Sebastian. Yeah, that would be, sorry for the white stripes there. Do we have to demonetize now or something? I don't know.
No, it should be fine. It's not long enough. And we're not monetized anyway. So subscribe to our YouTube feed so we can be monetized one day.
Yes, exactly. So I can get a better studio so I can't see my clippers around the corner.
Well, we need to get you better audio, but by the way, we're working on that. And thank you for your patience as we took us a while to get to both videos, and we're going to continue to bring this to a level of quality that is, of course, unmatched, because that's what we do here. But we wanted to also acknowledge that this is a work in progress, and we'll also have better production values down the road. But we hope you enjoyed the first video show of Duane and I in Soccer Today. You can subscribe to our YouTube page at youtube.com/sportspodcastnetwork. Subscribe to this show at Soccer Today SPN. 24th minute for Duane at Kevin Larmé for myself. And of course, the podcast is available as a podcast, of course, because it's a podcast. Everywhere you find your podcast, video replay on YouTube. And you can find the podcast version on our website if you don't find any favorite podcatchers, and everywhere else. We'll be back tomorrow with Tuesdays, because Tuesdays are for Europe and CCL for tomorrow. But as always, until next time, for Duane Rollins, I'm Kev Larmé. Have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.